Good afternoon, and thank you very much for attending to this Young Entrepreneur Panel. And I just want to make a brief remark. Remember, the only way that we can pursue social and economic development in any society is number one, through education, and number two, through entrepreneurship. Many of you that you are here, because some of you are really known in some of my classes, you are a fast forward undergraduate students. And I, undergraduate and graduate students. And I hope that you can take some lessons learned and best practices for finalists today, and you can put them into action, and you can go outside and make a positive difference in our community. Without further ado, I would like to introduce Stephanie Diaz, founder and designer of Love Always by SD, Vicente Fernandez, co-president of Sportsmania, and Calibe Thompson, author and television producer. Stephanie, Vicente, Calibe, thank you very much for being here with us. And I would like to start, if you can tell us a little bit about yourself and your successful entrepreneurial career. Stephanie?
So I first started Love Always when I was 18 because I really had a passion in something in my jewelry. And you know, when I first started, I didn't think that it was something that I could do long term. It was something that I would be able to turn into my career. This year I will be graduating from St. Thomas, and I'm really proud to say that it has become my career and it is what I'm going to be doing as I graduate. So when I first started Love Always, there's a lot of different jewelry companies out there. There's a lot that you see online. There's a lot that you may see on Instagram. There's a lot of different companies that do what I do. So when I first started, you have to really think, what is going to make you different? So that's how I started. I said, there isn't really a marketplace for customized jewelry, which is what I do. So I started to really do the customized jewelry. And I thought to myself, how am I going to make this known? Because you can have a really great product, but if nobody knows that product is there, if nobody knows that your product exists, how are you going to get the sales? So I started by sending it to people that I saw on Instagram that had large followings. And as soon as I sent to the first person I ever sent to, I immediately recognized that that's how I was going to get my sales. So how we work right now is we're all online. We don't have a retail space, everything is done online, and we ship. My customers, a lot of people ask me if my customers are out of Miami. Nope, they're not. None of my clientele is really out of Miami. It's all around the United States. We have a very successful Instagram presence. We have over 120,000 followers on Instagram. So we're very strong in that market. We have gotten a lot of press as well. We've been featured on the Today Show twice this year, Us Weekly, several publications. And I want to stress the importance of really having a unique product. My products, customized pieces, have been around for several years. They've been around. But the type of products that I offer in the marketplace are extremely unique. And they're unique because it's what I love to design. And I really hope that if you guys have a passion, that you guys know that you can make it something, you can make it a business, you can make anything a business. Like, for example, with me, I never thought that my love for jewelry would be something I could really make what I do for a living. And so I really want to stress that.
Thank you, and I'll say that. Thank you. Definitely helpful to have a television producer next to you in a presentation like this. But I will say that there is something to be said for being passionate about what you're doing. I never set out to be an entrepreneur. I went to school with a passion for sports media, believing I either wanted to be a sports writer or a documentary filmmaker. And I'm from Miami. Miami product, I went to Chicago. And when I got to Chicago, I realized that there were opportunities for me to create things there that were missing. so I went out and created this school's first organization for students who want to go to schools in this room. We didn't have a television station, so I went out and created a television station so that, you know, my family and friends back home could watch our football games and see the events that were happening around campus. And in that way, my entrepreneurial roots sort of started sprouting. And from there, and for complete transparency, my co-founder is actually my mom, who's up here in the front row. She was a successful entrepreneur, had her own advertising agency for 20 years before we started Sportsmania together. And she gave me a call in the spring of my freshman year at the University of Chicago and said, "Hey, Vincente, I want to start a sports website." And I said, "Mom, you're crazy. You don't even like sports." But, you know, she's an entrepreneur, and she's very adamant, and she sees opportunities in a way, as, you know, having that experience as an entrepreneur. And it got me thinking, and got us thinking together over the course of a few weeks about what was out there and what wasn't out there. And what we felt there was an opportunity to do, after giving it much thought, was you have all this great content being created on social media by newspaper writers, beat writers, journalists, athletes across the country. If we could curate all that content and bring it onto one platform, and then in return, you know, grow the audience of Sportsmania and the publishers who are creating that original content, we'd have something incredibly powerful. That's really how Sportsmania, which is the sports website and app that we co-founded together, started off. You know, and as you grow as a business, your business changes, it evolves, you pivot. You know, I was a film major and a creative writing minor in college, and now I'm dealing with semantic technology and artificial intelligence. The opposite of what I went to school for. But, you know, so with Sportsmania, what ended up happening is we curate content around diehards' favorite teams. But what we realized was these beat writers, even though they are topic specific, they'll still get off topic sometimes. You have the beat writer who's tweeting about how bad the I-95 traffic is, and you don't want that in your Miami Dolphins feed as a Dolphins fan. So the semantic technology goes in and cleans out what's not relevant to each team. Likewise, you know, the market changes. All of a sudden, ESPN and Bleacher Report saw the value of curation, real-time curation, so we had to advance our product even further. And the vision of sports media that was exploding the most was fantasy sports. And that was really the perfect application of our technology, season-long fantasy. So now we've created the only fantasy world market that lets you import your fantasy teams from ESPN, Real, or CBS, whatever platform you're playing on, and get real-time information, not only on your favorite teams, but on the players you have to help you make smarter line decisions. So since founding, we now have over 2.5 million users, monthly users on our app and our website, and we've raised you know, quite a bit of money here in Miami from great investors, and learned a lot in the process. And I'm happy to share more about that with you as the
Hi everybody, my name is Calibe Thompson. A little about me, I am Jamaican born. I just got here maybe 13 years ago. I went to school in Jamaica for architecture, and then I ran off and became a singer. I toured for a few years with Fina and Kevin Little and Kimani Marley. And I got off stage one day and somebody was recording something and they gave me this microphone and they're like, "Here, talk to the microphone." And that was the start of my television career. So I learned or you know, became comfortable standing in front of the camera. I'd have to edit my own content to do these little YouTube web clips and things for, you know, closed circuit television around South Florida. I was in music. I directed one of my own music videos and fell in love with that. And at one point, I just got up and I was like, I want to be a TV producer. In the beginning of 2013, I decided I was going to get a series on national television. Didn't know what it was going to be or how I was going to pay for it. I think early that year, I borrowed a bunch of money and did some small fitness show. Didn't go anywhere, but we had it on South Florida television on SFL 5 o'clock in the morning. A few months after that, the bug was in me. I was not sleeping in the nights. I was, you know, working around the clock because this was what I wanted to do. I got up one day and decided with a friend of mine, Chef Irie, that we were going to put a show together. I sold my car, which was my only large asset. I didn't have anybody else to borrow or steal money from. So I sold the car. found alumni from the one of these other schools, I won't say which one, but one of these other schools who had done film and television and put a pilot or a series, a small pilot series together. And, you know, I didn't go anywhere for a while. Sold my car, so I was, you know, riding a bicycle around for a while. And, you know, I didn't know what was going to happen or where it was going. I started doing a smaller broadcast and whatever. Anyway, long story short, a year later, here comes PBS calling. We went in and had a meeting, and, you know, a few months after that, that show became the first National Caribbean cooking series on PBS. So congrats to us for that. Other things. In the meantime, we put together a show called the Caribbean Diaspora Weekly, which started being broadcast throughout the Caribbean as well. That ended up in 20 plus Caribbean countries and 9 regions in the Northeast. That show is the one that you're seeing the flyers on your chair now. There's me. We're rebranding it. That's being called Island Origins. You know, that kind of shows you what the Caribbean American culture is like. So basically my company is about sharing Caribbean American culture, and we're trying to do it in a way, I use the analogy, there's a company called Golden Crust that does patties, which are, you know, Jamaican staple food, and their audience is Jamaican people. And there's Bahama Breeze, who has taken our culture and said, here world, this is what happens in the Caribbean. It's beautiful, it's accessible to everybody. That's what I like to do with my company, and that's where we are right now.
Thank you. In your opinion, which are the most important challenges that we have faced as an entrepreneur, and how we have overcome them?
I think one of the biggest challenges is really finding who your customer is. If you are in a business with sales, you have to find who your customer is. A few months ago, the things online, since my business is online, it really focuses on influential people on the social media, on the press, so things are always constantly changing. And if you don't change with the times, your company will unfortunately, it won't continue on. So a few months ago, back last year, at the end of last year, things started changing. A company called Reward Style, which if you're not familiar with Reward Style, Reward Style is responsible for any content you see on Instagram. I'm sure a lot of the girls in here will be familiar with that. If you follow any influencers on social media and you see something that says double tap the picture on Instagram and you'll get an email with the product links back to your email, that is something that is extremely important if you are in the industry that I am in or if you're trying to get in that industry. What that does is it gives the style influencers and anybody really that has a large following commission off of their sale that they bring in. Reward Style is responsible for $500 million of sales in the retail world. So really it's something that you guys should look into if you are looking at starting a business with sales, and I'll be happy to talk about that more in detail. So basically, a few months ago, or last year, I realized that if I didn't have that, my company would not be able to survive because people would not want to work with me. So that was something that I had to kind of figure out, see how I could work with and go forward. Because I have a lot of friends that also have companies that did not do that. And unfortunately, they haven't really been able to keep up with the times. So I would say one of the most important things to realize is what is happening in your industry and how you can keep up in order to keep growing. Because if you don't keep up with what's happening in your industry, it's not gonna happen. So I would say that's one of the most important things.
So there's a lot of challenges you're going to face as an entrepreneur, a lot of sleepless nights and work around the clock. I'll break it down to 3 challenges that I think, you know, are really critical to most entrepreneur ventures. The first is just getting started, right? A lot of people, I can't tell you how many times throughout the course of the year, this past year, I've gotten approached by good friends of mine, acquaintances, people who went to school or that want to start a company. A lot of them have great ideas. A lot of them are really smart people. But not one of them, and I get reached out, I have at least one conversation every 2 weeks, has actually gone out and started this company that they have the vision for. Getting started is hard. You have to commit to it. you're not going to be able to, you know, really build a business without fully dedicating yourself to what you're trying to build, whether that means bringing the right people around you, because you have a great idea for an app, but you don't have the programming skills to develop that actual app. So getting started is a big challenge. And my biggest recommendation there is speak to people who've done it before, but also surround yourself with people who believe in your vision and who want to work on it with you. Obviously, there's something to be said for entrepreneurs who do it on their own, but if your skill sets don't align exactly with what your vision is, you have to find somebody to complement. The second is fundraising, and you know, whether it's selling your car or getting 100 no's, your fundraising is going to be a challenge if that's the sort of business that you're going to go into. You're going to be told, and that's okay. Everybody's been told no who's had a startup and who's had a successful startup and who's run a successful business. The point is you have to continue putting yourself out there, finding the right connections for your business, and moving forward. And the last thing is goal. You know, as mentioned, you have to keep up with what is happening in your industry because people are going to start feeling the same voice that you're feeling. Or, you know, the audience is going to expect more and maybe they're not going to be coming back to your services quite as frequently. So you have to be ready to either pivot your business completely or evolve with the times as social media changes, as the market changes. And then I think those are the three challenges that most entrepreneurs face, and you know, that when you get to those roadblocks, you're going to be challenged, but you have to understand that you have to make it over that hump, and it's okay, everybody goes through.
Okay, I have right here these two notes, so I have to write my answers down. As an artist, one of the challenges that I have had to deal with is finding a balance between the things that folks want to consume. I think this is going to be the same in you guys' industry as well. Finding a balance between the things that people want to consume and finding a balance between what the people who are going to finance you are willing to finance. So for me, I'm dealing with island tourist boards and I'm dealing with television stations, and this island doesn't want to pay for something that's going to show that island in there. You know, it becomes this whole political thing. But people don't think of us as separate. People don't think of us as Jamaica and Trinidad and what have you. They think of you as Caribbean. So we have to find that balance, you know, in my instance. A second challenge is learning to let go of people. We talked about finding people who are like-minded and who want to move along the same trajectory in life that you want to move along. You're also going to have people around you who kind of want to hold you back. They'll see you doing this and they're comfortable here where they are and they don't want to go. You have to let go sometimes. And that's going to be difficult, but you know, that's dead weight holding you down rather than people helping you forward. So that's going to be a challenge number two. And then this business of no. It's just a word. My mother used to say to me, no is a complete sentence. It's not, you know, when people tell you no, you don't need this long explanation. I mean, if you're trying to get the business, no for me means try again tomorrow or try again next week. So that doesn't work with me if you're trying to get rid of me. You literally have to say, go away and don't talk to me. But as an entrepreneur, I'm sure you've done the same thing. It literally does. I've gone to people before and they'll tell me no today and, oh, they just had a bad day or it wasn't the right time or they didn't have enough money. Sometimes you do want to get the answer for that, but it doesn't mean give up on your dreams and give up on everything that you're aspiring towards. So those are my three challenges to overcome.
In your opinion, which are the most important skills that you need in your business and or in your business? Which skills do you look for people, and also how do you develop those skills?
Something that's very important in my industry is knowing what is going to sell. If I don't know what is going to sell, I can spend, you know, $2,000, $3,000 on a product that is just going to sit on the shelf. So you have to really, again, know your customer and know what they want to see. For example, I sell customized jewelry. For the winter, we're carrying also scarves. People were like, scarves? Why are you going to start carrying scarves? That has nothing to do with jewelry. Well, I figured that the monogram, the necklaces people wear are going to be covered by scarves this winter season. You're not going to be able to see my necklaces. So So what am I going to do if these necklaces are constantly covered by scarves? I said, well, I'm going to sell the scarves, and I know I'm not going to be making as much money as I make off of a customized necklace, but at least that scarf that they're wearing will be mine, and it won't be another company's. So that's kind of how you have to know your customer, and I'm happy to say that the scarves are doing well, and they are not sitting and collecting dust, so luckily for that, that has sold well. So I definitely just think it's really knowing what you're going to do, knowing your customer, knowing how you are going to ultimately get those sales and, you know, make money.
So the first two things I'm going to say are just across the board for many entrepreneurs, skills that I think are important and their, you know, quality of skills, quality of skills. And the third, is industry specific and similar to what you just heard. The first two that I think every entrepreneur needs is one, hustle. For all of the athletes in the room, like, you as an entrepreneur are going to hustle like crazy. You're going to be, I can't tell you, it's difficult to explain. In almost every instant of my day, my business, Sportsmania, is on my mind. And that is difficult. And to be able to, it's a testament, if that's going to happen to you, which it is as an entrepreneur, you need to be able to work it off, right? You need to be able to work your way to the next level and take steps and progress as a company. So hustle is absolutely important. The second is the ability to learn. You don't know everything. I didn't know everything when I started. No entrepreneur knew everything when I started. You need to learn on the job. There are things that you have no idea are coming in front of you, and you're gonna meet with an investor, and they're gonna say, hey, you know X, Y, and Z? And you're gonna look at them with a blank stare and say, man, I really should know X, Y, and Z. But you learn, and you move forward. So learning is absolutely critical, and the ability to pick up on the important pieces of information that you're hearing from a whole variety of sources, whether it's advisors or investors or customers, and balancing those out and creating the best business possible. And very specific to what I'm doing with Sportsmania is, and similar to what you just heard, but in the social and media content, social content specifically for us, the questions of will they click it, will they share it? That's something that, as the industry has changed, what is going to make people come to your app and what is going to grow the reach of Sportsmania is, and you're seeing it with companies like BuzzFeed, companies like Felice Report, that's what's led to their success. For us, the most recent example of what we've done as a company is we were thinking, okay, you have ESPN, you have Bleacher Report, you have CBS Sports. How are we going to distinguish Sportsmania and really get the first user in? Because once they're in, we see the retention, we see the way that they engage with the content, but we need something to really draw them and compel them. So what we released was the world's first fantasy football emoji key. So that, as people on Sunday are talking trash to their friends about how great their fantasy teams are doing, we're giving them emojis of the players they have on their teams. And what happens is every time an emoji is shared, just via text, which is the most valuable real estate in my opinion on your phone, which is your keyboard, every time an emoji is shared, they're inadvertently spreading the word and advertising towards names. Because the only way to get those emojis is through the app. So the next natural question is, where the heck did you get that emoji of Aaron Rodgers doing the discount double jump? And the answer is you have to download the Sportsmania app. So I would say the two things for any entrepreneur are hustle and the ability to learn. And then specifically for the digital media and social media field that that's what we're looking to go into, the two questions that I always ask myself and I ask our staff is, will they click it, will they share it?
For me, one of the main skills that has to be learned is focusing on your end goal. Looking at what you're trying to achieve at the end of the day, because if you don't, you end up kind of getting lost in minutia a lot of the time, including people, again, the people that you're around. In the television space, I'll spend $650 for a day on one video guy, one guy running around the camera, or doing the higher end productions. And so when people go off talking and having their smaller conversations, that's my money that's going down the toilet. If you snap at somebody or you say, can we get back to work or whatever it is, people will look at you and, oh, you're so mean, they call you the names and what have you. But guess what? You're wasting my $650 for the day. So that's a small example. But at the end of the day, you have to be watching. I don't want to say watch your pennies, but you literally have to be paying attention to this is what we're trying to achieve within this space of time. You have investors that you have to satisfy, so do you. At the end of the day, you know, there's a goal that has to be accomplished, and people's feelings and who is me, who you are me to, all that stuff, you know. As a business owner, you know, you love your staff, and you have to have the respect of your staff as well, but at the end of the day, the end game is the most important thing. The second thing, coming from entertainment, I have to say, learning to run your business as a business. There's going to be friends and family who are going to help you and want to help you build your business, but they're literally just kind of hanging on and taking up space. Your business is, you know what I'm talking about? Your business is your business. So the buddies and the pals and the people who want to come over and drink beer all the time, especially if you're in entertainment or sports or, you know, television, the things that I have come up around, you'll find that a lot. We had people who were making a ton of money and couldn't keep any of it because they're taking care of five baby mothers and cousins and uncles and the whole family. When it comes to your business, that's separate from everything else that you're doing. So, and then again, aligning with the right people is a skill. You're building a business, and a lot of the times the people that are going to help you out are your friends and family, but they can only take you so far. When I look at Oprah Winfrey and Tyler Perry, they have formed alliances and alignments that move them forward exponentially because of the connections that they have. So, and it's the same with you and your investors that you're coming to. I am in the process of finding investors as well. You can't do that within a certain community. You really have to find people who are, for me, I'm going to have to find people who are in the television industry. I can't find a shoemaker who has a bunch of money who's going to help you to get on the Oprah Winfrey Network. So think strategically about what you're doing, align yourself correctly, and that is my
number. With all these, let me deviate a little bit about the script. Do you have normal life? Can you share with us, like, what it looks like a normal day for you? Stephanie.
My day is majority spent in the car, unfortunately. My office is in Broward County, so I have to go downtown to pick up all of the stuff that is made downtown. So really, I wake up at around 6, I have breakfast in the car, I drive to downtown, pick up what I need to pick up, go back to the office, package about 500 to 1,000 orders, depending on the day, answer emails at night before I go to sleep. Go to sleep at about 11 o'clock after answering emails, and then wake up in the morning and do it again. So I do have, you know, you have to just balance everything. On the weekends, I really try not to work. I hate working on the weekends. In the holiday season, unfortunately, I have to work on the weekends, but I really cherish my weekend time. So during the week, I really do work a lot. I go to school 2 times a night, so I have to make sure that I'm at school on time. And the days that I have school, I plan around having school. So for example, if I have to go downtown, I'll go before I go to school since it's here. So it's really all just about planning and coordinating, making time, like what some of us were saying, making time for the people that are really there for you, like your family, your close friends. So you just really have to make sure to balance everything, but it's definitely possible to have a normal life.
So unfortunately, my life has gotten much less normal as this process has gone on. You know, people ask me, Vicente, what hours do you work? And my answer is, I am always working unless something important is coming up outside. So I will literally wake up every day of the week and get right to my laptop. And I will be doing that until I go to sleep. I have things in between, don't get me wrong, you know, I'll have my meals. For example, you know, obviously, you know, being here at St. Thomas and the values that you guys are getting, my brother had his confirmation, you know, last weekend, and I spent a full day with him, and like, there are valuable moments that take me away from the work that I'm doing. But there are no hours, for me, at this point in my career. always working on Sportsmania. It is incredibly challenging, and thankfully though, you know, it is important to have people who are important to your life, because that support's important, because you're going to have moments that are difficult for you mentally and emotionally, because you know, you already told no so many times, and sometimes you know, you're going to be like, man, I just, yeah, so it's nice to have, you know, somebody there for you, and it's important to have, whether it's family members or friends or significant other, that can bring you back to reality, at least for a few moments, you know, throughout the day or throughout the week. The last thing I want to say before I hand it over is when I was talking about hustle, this is hustle, right, on every chair.
We have to do what we have to do. There is no normal. I mean, I saw this question on here, you know, how do you keep your God, family, learning, life, work balance? I was like, what balance are you talking about? I get up at 5:30, between 5:30 and 6 every morning, depending on what I have to do. It might be 5, it might be 4:30. I usually don't go to bed until midnight, 1 o'clock. My sister's visiting. She said, why are you always awake? But there's always something to be done. And, you know, I used to do the same thing. When I had the laptop in the room, I would roll over and get onto the laptop. The laptop is now downstairs, so I actually go brush my teeth first and then go onto the laptop. But it is that kind of all day long, you're in work mode. And it becomes stressful on your relationships, because people will say to you, you know, how are you doing? And your first response is going to be, oh, the work is a little. And they'll be like, no, I mean your life. You know, and for us there is, I'm saying for you, there is no life outside of your work. I mean, I had this conversation the other day too. I don't have children, I don't know when I'm gonna have children, I don't have a husband, I'm not dating. All of that is taken up by the work, and I'm okay with that. I'm comfortable with that. I'm looking at Oprah Winfrey, who is my kind of idol and who I'd like to be. And she has a dog on Stedman, so, you know, it'll be okay on a bunch of money. And the legacy that, you know, it's about what is the legacy that you want to leave. And there's some people who want to leave a legacy of family and children, and that's a very important thing to them. I have a big enough family. I have 6 sisters, but we didn't grow up together in a bunch of closeness. So the importance of having family around is not the same for me as it is for everyone else. But I want to leave a legacy, and this is the way that I'm finding to leave that legacy. And it becomes all-consuming, so breakfast doesn't mean as much as sending off this email, because I might see a check for $20,000, or, you know, the priorities just become very different. So that's how I'm going.
In your own way, you are visualized. Your business, your industry. In your perspective, what it takes to be in Facebook, in Uber, in Snapchat, or the successful business person that you are now, what it takes to get there?
If you could just raise your hand, who has a passion, something that you really enjoy in here? You know that you could, whatever your passion is, I promise you, you could make money out of it. I know somebody that their passion happens to be, they like making decorations for the house with paper. They make paper tassel garlands. It's actually a very good friend of mine. She's in LA. I don't think she ever thought she could make a job out of making paper tassel garlands. And her company is sold in Urban Outfitters, Nordstrom. So you can make a company out of anything. You can make money out of anything. It just has to, I truly strongly believe that you have to really love what you're doing. Because like what they said, if you do not live, sleep, breathe what you're doing, you're gonna be miserable. And if you're miserable, you're not gonna be able to function. And it's just, you have to really love what you're doing. Like for example, the Facebook guy, or the Instagram guy. If you really study what they loved and what they did. They love what they do. That Mark Zuckerberg, he wanted to change the world and do that. Like, that was his passion. I'm not sure if he dropped out of Harvard. I think he did drop out of Harvard. And you know, people were like, to drop out of Harvard, that's insane. Well, he had a vision and he was so passionate about what he does. So I truly think that if you are passionate and you love what you're doing, and you wake up and you hustle every day and you give up the sacrifices, you know, maybe one night you can't stay out till 3 o'clock in the morning, or one, you know, maybe you can't buy something that you really want to buy. If you can do that, I really truly believe that you will be successful, and then you can grow to be the Facebook of your industry or the Snapchat of your industry. So I really just think it's about what you love and what you're passionate about.
Yeah, I would agree that passion is incredibly important. You know, it's going to get tough. It's going to get tough. And in those tough moments, you have to love what you're doing, because a lot of people, when they hit those moments, they stop. Right? And you know, having hit those moments before, I understand where they're coming from. So you have to love what you're doing to the extent that you want to overcome that. I also think, you know, as I mentioned, you have to be willing to dedicate yourself and hustle your way to success. You have to be flexible and ready to learn so that as things change and evolve, you can change and evolve with it to make it, you know, to make your company, your venture, what it can become and as successful as it can be. And the third is something, you know, obviously those qualities are critical, but being passionate about what you're doing, being, you know, willing to learn and smart about the way you position yourself and hustling. The fourth factor is out of your control, it's circumstance. You may be a brilliant person who works incredibly hard and had a great idea, but if the situation doesn't align itself, sometimes things might not go the way you want them to. And situation can be timing as well, right? There's a lot of great companies that have gone down because they were a few years too early or a few years too late. So circumstance is out of your control. What you can't control is how hard you work, how well you learn and adapt your business in an intelligent way, and obviously, you know, as you're starting, making sure that this is something that you love and that you're willing to dedicate yourself to.
I think it was a book called Think and Grow Rich that, I forget the name of the author, but he spoke about burning every bridge that's in your life, so you leave yourself no escape route when you made a decision that you're going to do whatever it is that you're going to do. And the similarity that I see with all of these people is that they do that. They leave themselves no escape route, so they have to make it work, as well as they're now, you know, taking the passion, that's one part of it. You have to love what you're doing, but you also have to have this roadmap. I went to the SBDC, Small Business Development Council, and they've helped me with a business plan that kind of shows where the beginning is, where the end is, and the routes that you can take to get, you know, to move along that path. It's about finding, aligning yourself with the right people, having a plan in place, having plan B and plan C, being able to switch around, kind of a hybrid of everything that's been mentioned here, but, you know, having that clear path and deciding that hell or high water you're going to make.
Probably along your entrepreneurship career, you have had all successes all around. Which has been your major failures, and what have you learned of your main major failures?
Well, I'll give an example. I think this question is best answered with an example. Last holiday season, I wanted to, since everything is customized, there's a certain date that things need to be in order to arrive by the holidays. And I underestimated how many sales there were going to be. So I made the cutoff December 15th to be there by December 24th. And unfortunately, that did not happen. So there were about 70 people that didn't receive their order for Christmas. And when you look at it on a large scale, on how many orders we received, it was, you know, it wasn't a significant number. It wasn't material. It was maybe 5%, 3% of the orders, maybe not even. So it wasn't material, but I felt really bad. I mean, thinking that there were people that couldn't have their gift by the holidays. So you have to kind of compensate for that. So I individually emailed every single person that did not receive their order. I gave them a gift card. You know, that was a really bad mistake on my part. And so now for this year, for the holidays, everything is different. That will not happen again this year. The cutoff date is different. So I kind of rearranged everything from that. So I think that the failure from that is really going to help make this holiday season really successful. So I think from failures, you actually learn tremendously. Because, for example, if that wouldn't have happened to me last year, maybe this year I would have, you know, had the same deadline, December 15th, and I would have not gotten 500 orders out, 400 orders out, and then that's a problem. So, you know, I learned from that, I'm able to change it and move forward, and that's that.
I would say, I'm sure my biggest failure is still ahead of me, but I would say one of our biggest failures at this point, I mentioned briefly earlier semantic technology and artificial intelligence. We knew it was going to be an important part of our business within a few months of starting Sportsmania and starting to aggregate this content. It was going to be absolutely crucial to real-time curation and making sure that these feeds were the best in the business. I did not have a lot of experience in this field, and neither did our internal team. So, you know, we proceeded and looked for candidates, and we found one that we thought was the right candidate. And it turned out it wasn't, right? We weren't able to produce what we wanted to, and it took time and it took money, and it was definitely a step back. And the thing that happens is you accept it, you learn from it, now you know what you're looking for after a failure like that. Thankfully, we were able to find other machine learning experts to bring in and work with us on the technology, and now we got it right. But those sort of moments definitely can affect your business. But there's, like you said earlier, there's a roadmap, right? And you need to hit that roadmap and sort of form yourself into a position where you need to make it work. And all you can do is learn from it and take that next step forward, even though it takes a few back.
I don't know that I can single out one thing. I'm just going to pull something randomly. So there was a week when we were shooting and I had to make payroll, and the person I thought would have helped with financing to get the payroll done backs me up and says to me, well, if I'm going to give you this, it was a small amount, and he says, well, if I'm going to give you this, what are you going to give me? I want half of your company. And in my mind, here we are shooting national television show and have a number of these products going on, whatever, but because we had not, and this is part of the conundrum, you can have this huge footprint and not be generating revenue as yet. So that's our situation. We had this huge footprint, but we weren't generating a whole bunch of revenue. So he goes, oh, well, this is what you made last year. I'm not going to give you any more than this. And that kind of, I had my camera crew in, I had all my talent in, I had everybody in, and Friday's going to come and I'm not going to be able to pay these people, but I'm not giving this man half of my company for a few thousand dollars to get through the week. And, again, you have to have good relationships. As much as you're cracking the whip, you have to have good relationships with your people. They know how much I go through and our whole team goes through to get the thing through the door. And so I was able to give everybody a check and say, can you hold on to this? I'm going to get it to you within a few weeks, a week or two. And I was able to borrow from other friends until that check did come in and we were able to cover everything. But it kind of showed me, be careful who you're working with and who you're tying yourself to. And don't marry, business contracts are marriages. So be careful who you're getting into bed with, so to speak, because you think people are one way or not, so that's my lesson.
In your own business and industry, what's the problem that you are trying to solve with your business? And what's the solution and what's the value add? In other words, why people they buy from you?
I would say, since I am in more of the fashion space, that people are buying from me because they saw somebody wearing the product. That is the majority of where my sales come from. A majority of my sales are coming from top social influencers in the market space that, you saw your favorite blogger, or you saw the celebrity, or you saw it in the magazine. So I am my sales are coming from trends, really. So, for example, we created a trend. One of the top fashion bloggers, she came to me, she's a good friend of mine. She came to me and she said, I really want this extra, extra large monogram necklace. And basically, a monogram necklace is the necklace with initials. And I said, you're crazy. I was like, that's not gonna sell. But whatever, she said she wanted it, so I created it for her. It's crazy how many of those necklaces we sell. Would I personally wear the necklace? I don't think so. But she wears it. Everybody really it seems to enjoy the necklace. And just because it's not maybe my favorite, it happens to be a lot of people's favorites because we've sold thousands of these necklaces. And you know, so really, it's just it's what these in my industry, what these style influencers are wearing or what trend they want to create. So I'm just kind of going with the trends, helping them create the trend, and that's pretty much where we stand.
So for Sportsmania, the problem that we're solving is there's 60 million fantasy football and fantasy sports fanatics across the United States, and they're pretty obsessive about getting information on their players and their teams to help them make smarter line decisions, meet their friends, and talk trash. The problem is they're visiting, the average fantasy player on average is visiting 6 different websites and apps a week to get information on their players. And a large part of that is because they have players across the league, right? So they'll have somebody on the Indianapolis Colts, which means they have to read the Indianapolis Star. They'll have somebody on the Cincinnati Bengals and reading the Cincinnati Inquirer. They'll want to read the ESPN Matthew Berry blog that's talking about their running back. And up until this point, a tool didn't exist that brought all of the information from all of the top sources in real time from social media feeds like Twitter into one place, organized and curated for them. And that's what Sportsmania is, and that's why we do Sportsmania. We are taking all of the noise on social media, taking the best of it, right? The best information and content that's relevant to sports fans and fantasy players, and personalizing it to their interests. So they don't have to go visit 6 different websites to get the information they need to run the league. They can get it all in one place, easily, quickly, and well.
We are doing, for the Caribbean community, we are kind of introducing who we are to everyone else. So, and to ourselves. For us, when we look at ourselves on any kind of media, it's usually something to do with entertainment or something to do with nursing. You know, you think of Caribbean people, it's either a nurse or an entertainer. And we are so much more than that. The Jamaican community, I'll just share with you, that the Jamaican community is the wealthiest subset of the Black American community. We are doing very special things, and my objective is to showcase that good side of who we are, not the side where Pushbatton is going to jail or Ellis is being arrested or, you know, all of these other sensationalized things. Haiti is being bombarded by, you know, earthquakes and, you know, issues with the Dominican Republic. There is this dark side of what you hear about the Caribbean, and then there's the sunset and sea, and there's nothing in between. So our objective is to fill that gap and to make that palatable for our own community, so that we know that we're doing other things and there are other things we can aspire to, and to make people smile and be entertained.
Before we open the floor for questions and answers, I would like to ask you, which advice would you give to our orthographic and grammar psychology university students that they want to start their careers as and be successful?
My biggest piece of advice is try. He said, you know so many people who talk to him about starting a business and it never happens. That happens over and over and over because people don't try. I don't think I'm the best producer in the world. I didn't go to school for it. I have no background in it. But I got onto these platforms because I thought, okay, where is there a void that I can fill? How can I do that most effectively? And then we just try and see what happens. and it may not materialize right away, it may not happen the exact way that you plan it over on a piece of paper, but if you don't try, you're not going to know. And most people have decided they're going to fail before they even put a foot out the door. So take that restriction out of your own head. I'm looking in the room right now, and for me, when I was your age, I would have been in the front room, not in the back, and the room was very back heavy today. It says to me that we kind of think you might want to do something, but you're not sure, so let me sit in the back and I don't know, let me be shy and let me reserve myself. Be that person that is out there and doing stuff and trying and dabbling in everything. Be present. But if you don't dip your toe in the water, if you don't jump in, you're never going to know if it will happen or not. Unless it happens like me, so yeah.
So I think she took the mic first because she knew what I was going to say. But my word wasn't try, it was commit. But essentially the same message. Once you have the idea that you want to go after, the only thing standing between you and that idea is you. You just have to commit to it and get started. And that doesn't mean continue to think about it, right? Obviously research is important, and it's important to be as knowledgeable about the risk that you're going to take before you take. But once you have that knowledge, once you have that research done, you need to move forward. If you don't take that step and get started, your idea is never, ever going to come to fruition. So my words are commitment.
My advice is to work really, really hard. Especially, it's important to work really hard when you, throughout the whole process, but especially when you first start out. You have to work really, really hard. And one of my favorite quotes by Mark Cuban is, work as if somebody is working 24 hours a day, like they're gonna take it all away from you. And just like in every single business here or every single business out there, you're always gonna have competition. Unless you're a monopoly, you are going to have competition. And if you, let's say, your company doesn't work for one day or 2 days, or even if you're an entrepreneur and it's a small business, if you don't work for one day, you're gonna fall so behind just from that one day not working. So you have to work really hard, and people are not gonna think your idea is a good idea. Not everybody's gonna think your idea is a good idea. But if you work really hard, you're really passionate, and you truly believe that you could be successful, you will be. And just remember, just something that I always emphasize is that you can make money literally off of any business that you are passionate about. I have so many friends that I'll tell my parents about their business, and they're like, how did they make money from that? Like, who buys that? Like, how do you? And I'm like, I don't know, but it works. I mean, one of my best friends, for example, is a fashion blogger. And when I told my parents that she's a fashion blogger, they were like, well, what did she study? And I was like, well, she went to Virginia Tech for this, but she is a fashion blogger, and she makes, over $30,000 posting pictures of her outfits on social media and on blogs. So there literally is a business space for you, no matter what. It's awesome. School is awesome, and my accounting that I'm studying helps me every single day with what I do, and I'm really thankful for that. But there's nothing like doing what you love and being able to make money from it and being able to live from that.
And learn something every day as well. Make it a mission that you're always learning something. You never know everything. You will see at the beginning, what you were doing at the beginning of your journey as opposed to where you are now. You can see the difference, and that experience, the experience of failing and getting up again and doing it again, that's going to make you stronger and get you.
Now I would like to open the floor for any questions that you might have for our panelists.
Yes. Are you designing this stuff or do you
when I first started my business, everything was bought overseas, and we didn't make anything. Nothing was made here, but now 90% of what I have on my website is handmade in Miami, Florida. And that's something that I'm really proud of, because we're bringing jobs to American people and we're supporting the American industry. And so yeah, 90% of it is made here. I design, I would say about 50% of it, and other things are things that I may see in everyday life or in a magazine, and I kind of put my own spin to it. So it's not identical copies to anything, but it's, you know, it's a spin to everything. Monograms is something I sell, and that's my main market of what I sell. And that's been around since my mom was, she had a monogram when she was 15. So monograms have been around forever, but it's my spin. I promise you that you will not find a monogram design that looks the same as mine, and that's kind of how I do it.
Anybody else?
Thank you very much for your time, first of all. I'm an MBA student here with a specialization in marketing, and I was wondering, I was quite curious what your marketing techniques that you used at the beginning, at the entry stage of your business. If you could elaborate on that.
A lot of people don't believe me when I say this, but I have never paid a single dollar in advertising. I have never paid anything in any sort of advertising. My advertising comes from social people in the social world. For example, porn style. If you are not familiar with that, and if you are in an industry like mine, I highly, highly recommend following up on that, because I don't foresee that in a year, that if you are in the same market that I am in, I don't think you will be able to continue business. Because what's happening now is, not even just in the blog world, in every industry, people that are on social media and they are what bring you sales, they don't want to work for free. They're not going to, if they have 500,000 Instagram followers, they're not going to post your thing for free. Now, do I want to pay them a bunch of money to post it? No, I want them to put, kind of like put their mouth where their money is. I want them, okay, you say you can bring me this much sales. Well, you'll make money off of me, but you'll make commission off of me. And that's what reward style does. So for every sale of somebody brings me that is in that social industry, they will get 15% commission. So I'm not giving them an upfront, and if they bring me the sale, that was a sale I wasn't gonna get. So I see that as that 15% that they're getting. It's great because I'm making money, they're making money, they work hard at what they do, so they should also be getting paid. So I highly recommend that if that's in the industry that you're in.
More questions.
If you would have to say one quality for female entrepreneurship, what would it be? Like, if you just had one quality of describing an entrepreneur, what quality would you for what?
Yeah, I'm going to go back. You know, I was recently asked this question in an interview for an online publication, and my word was hustle, and I stick with it. But, for all the athletes in the room, you know the value of hustle, and for all the entrepreneurs in the room, you know the value of hustle too. You gotta be willing to, work. Again, there's somebody working to take it away from you, because every hour that you're not working, it's an hour that your company's not progressing. That's not to say that there aren't things that are valuable worth your time outside of work, but when you have the opportunity to be advancing, you absolutely should.
My word is going to be persistence. That's kind of self-explanatory. That not taking no for an answer, that, the whole thing about quitters never win, just keep going. You always have to be willing to keep going.
I'm going to stick with mine. Work really hard and really good things will happen.
Luca, I have a question for Calibe. Who or what inspired you the most to be an entrepreneur?
Who or what inspired me the most? I don't know that it was a person or a thing. I'm from a household where my father was an entrepreneur. My mother was not, but I did not see going out and working for somebody else as a path for me. My mother has done that all of her life. I never saw my father do that path from the time I was 4 years old. And so it's never been a comfortable space in my mind. I've done it before, didn't like it. it depends on your personality as well, I think. If you are somebody who is okay with conforming and falling in line or what have you, I will be rude to people, you know, if they're trying to deal with me in a particular way. And you don't always find that in a corporation or whatever, people have respect for you. And that happened one too many times. I've had 3 jobs in life, but it happened one too many times. I was like, really? So, you know, it's obviously not the easy path to go, but I think it's easier if you have seen people around you do something on their own and be successful and be able to sustain a household in that way. It makes you a little bit more comfortable to go that way. It's just as good to have a good job and be a tenured professor and all these wonderful things. It's just not for everyone's personality. Anybody else?
You're all quite young now. Where do you see yourselves in 5 years, especially with the world changing so quickly?
So the honest answer on my end is I have no idea. If you asked me that 5 years ago, I could not have given you anything close to where I am today. So I mean, that's the beauty of it. Like, I love that uncertainty. You know, it means that the, you know, things in my life are still wide open, right? They can go in any direction, and I'm in control.
We do have a business plan.
But you know, for like with Sportsmania specifically, you know, we want to become sort of what Bleach Report has become in the last 5 years, but for fantasy sports, right? We want to be the dominant fantasy tool, Sportsmania. Obviously servicing them even beyond that, right? So it's the news on their players, it's the news on their teams, and it's the whole messaging platform where they can talk trash. But as an individual, I don't know where I've been in 5 years, and I'm pretty cool with it.
I see my company, honestly, how I would like to see my company, and I'm going to work really hard to make that happen. I see myself, my company, being a multi-million-dollar company and really just taking over the market for costume and for personalized jewelry. I mean, that's what I would like. I don't know what's going to happen.
I see myself having established a real company. Like, even though I don't see myself as a business person, my sister always argues with me about saying that, but I still see myself as an artist, and I'm learning to become a business person and care about numbers and not just how pretty the thing looks. But I see myself in 5 years having a properly established company with a properly established staff and a footprint and an influence, and building that legacy that I talk about. I see movies and television. I see serial. Most of what we do right now is lifestyle and reality-based type stuff. I see serial, I see television and movies. I see retreating to an island every now and again, like Tyler Perry does. That's what I see in 5 years.
Any other questions? Before we go, I would like to invite you. Tonight we have another event within our St. Thomas University Global Entrepreneurship Week, sponsored by the Good Machado School of Business. We have an amazing event that is called Immigrant Entrepreneurs Growing the Nation. And it's from 7 to 9 p.m., where we will have not just the panel presentation of these immigrant entrepreneurs in South Florida, but also we will have a reception and we will have a network and connection event. So you are all cordially invited to attend to this event. So before we go, I would like to read a brief part from the book of Steve Jobs that I think very well represents today our young entrepreneurs that we have here, Stephanie, Calibe, and Vicente. Here's to the crazy ones, the misfits,
the rebels, the troublemakers, the round pegs in the square holes, the ones who see things differently. They are not fond of rules, and they have no respect for the status quo. You can quote them, disagree with them, glorify or vilify them. About the only thing you can do is to love. Because they change things, they push the human race forward. And while some may see them as the crazy one, we see them as a genius. Because the people who are crazy enough to think they can change the world are the ones who do. Thank you very much for your attention.